Welcome, finally, to this large presentation of all of the music that I've been writing in quarantine. So my name is Nick Amardella, for those of you who don't know me. For those of you who do know me, sorry if I've been hiding in Quarantineville. I've been writing a lot of music and taking advantage of the time that I have. So what you're gonna hear are a bunch of works, mostly orchestral, all composed by me, leading up to tonight's premiere of my very first symphony. Before this video continues, I would just like to thank Wallander Instruments and Spitfire Audio for the great support in creating amazing professional sound libraries to make this album and this video possible. Quarantine sucks. And I'm sure that's a statement that you guys all will easily commend, but I mean, honestly, I mean, it's really hard, having to go home, be doing the rest of my semester online and everything, be social distancing, leaving my friends. So I found some great ways to fill in the quarantine gaps. I discovered that I love tuna sandwiches, which was a really good start. I made sure that I keep in touch with my friends as well as, my family at home. I also taught myself how to play chess, which is really, I'm not great at all at it, but it's really fun and I love it. And I also came to a realization early on in quarantine, before I even left school. I realized that when I'm at school and with my friends, I don't have any time to be writing much music on my own. And suddenly I got that time. And in that time, I learned an interesting fact about the very well-known Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. I learned that he was 7 years old when he completed his first symphony. And for a child at that age, I viewed that as a message for me. And that was, why wait? I'm studying at Berklee College of Music in Boston, Massachusetts, soon to be a sophomore. And I'm a double major in music composition and film scoring there. But during this period of quarantine, I realized that, I had time to come up with brand new ideas and I had time to study others in order to do well on my own. So first, you're gonna hear 12 original pieces of music, all composed by me. And then you're gonna hear, for the first time ever, my very first symphony, written in four movements. For each piece, I'm also gonna talk about, what's significantly impactful of each piece before you hear it, and also what inspired me to write this piece. The music obviously is not live, it's digital. Thank you to our synthetic advantages to this day and age, I was able to make it sound somewhat real, as real as it can. And I know it's not super musical when it's not a people playing, actual people playing it. But you know what? I think I could get each message across. So as an aspiring film composer, I also want to be a composer of concert literature as well, just write for orchestra, for the sake of just being music. And one of the places that redirected my musical interests was Disney World. My family has been going there for many, many years, also canceled by COVID-19. But at Epcot in particular, the Epcot Park, there's such a weird variety of musical styles. My favorite one being at the Fountain of Nations by the Epcot Ball. So for this piece, very simple, I did my best to tell a story what I see when I look at the fountain, in hopes that someday this piece may be played in the Epcot Park. Unfortunately, I'm pretty sure they're getting rid of the fountain with the new Epcot extension, but it also has that connection to the park as well.
Thank you.
the people who know me and know my musical taste, you know that my favorite film score is Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, which is a score composed by John Williams. And this score is mostly responsible for building my interest toward music and film. But, you know, the great thing about John Williams as a composer is his gift for seeing the beauty of the scores outside of the film. He likes to write symphonic suites for many of his amazing film scores, which one of which was for the first Harry Potter. What's interesting about this suite is that a decent amount of the movements within the suite have a very small instrumentation. So there's, like, you know, a quartet, there's a quintet, there's a trio, a duet, you know. And so here are a few examples of what they are.
There's a three-headed dog who guards a secret chamber. And of course, when he's awake, nobody can get past the sleeping dog. The dog is called Fluffy, incidentally. And there's a magic harp that kept Fluffy asleep. And as long as the harp music was playing, we were safe to go into the chamber because the guard dog, the three-headed guard dog, would be asleep. Hence, the music of the magic harp, played by the harp itself, of course, and Fluffy, the three-headed guard dog, who's big and threatening and ominous, characterized by the contrabassoon, which has the lowest pitches of all the orchestra, and putting these two unlikely instruments together in a sort of somnambulant duet.
You know, you don't need a whole orchestra to sound great or to sound big. You know, just get one player. Hans Zimmer once said, you know, that he would just get one player to just play the crap out of their instrument. Because of all of this, I decided to pick three random instruments, which I decided were clarinet, bassoon, and cello. And I wrote a trio based on these instruments. It's interesting when you think about it, because the clarinet is in the mid to high register, and the bassoon and cello is really mid to low register. So it's kind of like a two-way battle if you think about it like that. The name Quicker Steps is actually a reference to my first ever album, which is titled Walk Before You Run. And the idea behind Walk Before You Run was that I was trying to pace myself when learning to compose. And in the album, the first three pieces were on piano, and then you hear guitar, voice, brass, wind ensemble, and then you also hear a mock-up rescoring of The Incredibles. So in this piece here, you know, as I develop as a composer, I'm able to challenge myself to take these quicker steps. The inspiration of the next piece stylistically comes from a lot of unique sources. You know, I there was no particular style that I was really going for. I kind of was just feeling it. But if there was anything that inspired me stylistically, it was a piece by Ravel that's titled Le Tambo de Couperin. Writing Quicker Steps left me with a lot of questions, like, you know, what is the tone of this whole thing? You know, what am I going for? I had to think about, you know, what the piece is supposed to represent. And, you know, relating to Walk Before You Run, this is kind of this point in these steps. And in the long run, it's really about just leaving a mark in my journey. Since I already started it before I even, you know, came up with this idea for the story, I was lucky enough that what I had already written kind of fits the feel of the story itself, and it was malleable enough that I didn't have to make too many changes. So my grandmother and I have always had this great unique relationship. First of all, we have the same birthday. One time when I was like 4 years old, before I even started kindergarten, I remember, well, we had a very out-of-tune piano, you know, not like this one. It was in our old house, same town, different house, and it was a very out-of-tune piano. And I remember coming home from a school assembly and playing the school song. So it sounded a little bit like this. And I also remember that after all these years. Nobody was interesting because I had never heard that before. This was before I even started kindergarten, like I said. I was in preschool. So it was technically my sister's assembly. So when we came home from the assembly, our grandma was also with us. She said she heard me playing that on piano, and I never heard that before. I only heard it that day when I went to my sister's school assembly. And once she heard me play that, she said to my mom, "There's something you need to do with that kid because he has a gift that not many people have."
I told your mother you got to do something with that child.
And if she hadn't said anything, I wouldn't have thought of it. I was sitting on the piano. This was like about a year later. I was like 5 years old, and I was just plunking out these notes. Thank you. the moment that I finished playing Silent Night that one night, it did not become a silent night because I was screaming with joy. I ran to the kitchen and I went up to my mom and I was like, I want to take piano lessons. And, you know, to her, and she, you know, she remembers this too. So obviously she's, you know, she said, you know, in her head, she was like, oh, I wonder how long this is going to last. But so you thought, Mom. So, you know, every Christmas, you know, I end up playing piano at some point and they're just used to it. You know, sometimes they sit and watch. Sometimes they just have it as background music. But every time I would play, my grandma would always, whenever I would start, walk over here to this, you can't see it, but that couch over there. And she would just sit and listen to me play every Christmas night. And, you know, I would consider her for sure my number one fan. And it's interesting because I share a birthday with my number one fan. Last May, she passed away. And the night before she did, I had a weird dream. It wasn't even, it was weird. It didn't even feel like a dream. It felt like a slideshow. It was like I was seeing a slideshow in my head of a bunch of different pictures of her, you know, when she was young and when she was older. And, you know, I don't know, in the morning I didn't know what that meant. But what's interesting is the next night I had a dream that I got these pastries. And then I woke up, I didn't have pastries in my bed, but I later that night, my mom came home from my aunt's house with a box of pastries. What's crazier is there was another one. Later that day, or maybe it was the next day, I don't even remember. My aunt was on the phone with my mom, and she told her that a friend came with yellow roses. That was her favorite flower. So, of course, in you know, because of all of this, I decided to obviously write a piece in honor of her. And I didn't want to make it this huge, elaborate orchestral piece because I figured the thing that she'd want to hear most is just me playing piano. As if she was sitting right there. I recorded it on this piano. This is the one live performance that you get in this whole album. So I played it on here, and you're gonna hear it right now. So I hope you enjoy. It is titled Pictures, Pastries, and Yellow Roses. As I said before, I'm especially interested in composing music for film and really any form of visual media, you know, whether that's movies, television, video games, theme parks are a big one. But, you know, to me, music supports a story in a film because music as a concept is really just an extension of who we are. And so is film. So I think putting the two art forms together have this very great marriage. Because of all of that, and because of my interest, I figured I'd pick two empty film scenes to compose an underscore to. So I could say it was an interesting success. So the first scene that I picked was from Pixar's Monsters University. And I'm going to play the movie clip as I first saw it with no music. Keep in mind, the voices are not from the original actors. I just remastered them for people like me to practice scoring. So take a look.
What the...
Archie!
Ah!
Ooh!
Hey, what are you?
Shh.
What? You're shushing me? Hey, you can't.
Where'd he go?
He's dead. That guy's in big trouble.
Yeah, he is. Hey, guys, over here.
Fiatech dummies. Sorry about that, buddy.
Why are you in my room?
Your room? This is not my room. Archie, come here, boy!
Wait, Archie.
Archie the Scare Pig. He's Fiatech's mascot.
Why is it here?
I stole it. Gonna take it to the Roar.
The what?
Roar Omega Roar. The top fraternity on campus. They only accept the highly elite. Okay, I'll lift the bed, you grab the pig. You ready?
What?
One,
no,
two, three.
No.
Don't let go. Careful, he's a biter. Whoa. I got him. Whoa. That was awesome. What am I doing? James P. Sullivan.
Mike Wazowski. Listen, it was quite delightful meeting you and whatever that is, but if you don't mind, I have to study my scaring.
You don't need to study scaring, you just do it.
Really? I think there's a little more to it than that. But hey, thanks for stopping by. Let go of that! My hat!
My pig!
So, yeah, there was not too much to go off of that scene, but I figured, you know, I still would keep a few things in mind. So I wrote this, a brand new theme, which you see when they're showing, you know, the kind of the relationship between Sully and Mike and their first interaction. And then there was the pig. The pig parts, I think are what made this a lot more interesting, because the theme for Mike and Sully is that I wrote. And then the pig is chaotic, but the pig is also harmless. I would say the pig is just a pig. You know, it's not this big. It's not gonna kill you. It's just gonna go crazy. So I decided because of that, I think to add to the comedic effect, I would make the pig sound threatening by adding this super insane action moment that just comes out of nowhere. So let's see how that turned out.
What the?
Archie! Ooh!
Hey, what are you?
Shh.
What? You're shushing me? Hey, you can't.
Where'd he go?
He's dead. That guy's in big trouble.
Yeah, he is. Hey, guys, over here.
Fiatech dummies. Sorry about that, buddy.
Why are you in my room?
Your room? This is not my room. Archie, come here, boy.
Wait.
Archie the Scare Pig. He's Fiatech's mascot.
Why is it here?
I stole it. Gonna take it to the Roar.
The what?
Roar Omega Roar? The top fraternity on campus? They only accept the highly elite. Okay, I'll lift the bed, you grab the pig. You ready? One,
no,
two, three.
No.
Don't let go. Careful, he's a biter. Whoa. I got him. Whoa. That was awesome. What am I doing? James P. Sullivan.
Mike Wazowski. Listen, it was quite delightful meeting you and whatever that is, but if you don't mind, I have to study my scaring.
You don't need to study scaring, you just do it.
Really? I think there's a little more to it than that. But hey, thanks for stopping by. Let go of that! My hat!
My pig!
So the next scene is from Westworld. Well, actually, the scene was technically for a contest, which I missed out on. So I decided to you know, do it for this project. So let me show you first what it looked like.
Gino, stand by.
Got it.
Verified. Enable semi-automatic control. Disable safety features. Maximum speed. Go. What's happening to him?
I think he's switching genres.
We need distance. Head south.
Isn't that a standard issue?
No. It's not. Point and shoot. Ahead. Maintain speed.
Maintaining speed.
Sharp left. Now.
I missed!
Hold on.
Oh, fuck.
All right, I need you. Drop in, intersect, maximum speed. Arm charges now. Accelerate.
Acceleration at 90%.
More.
94%.
More.
98%.
Stop.
Why the f*** are we stopping?
Get down.
What's interesting is that I noticed after I completed the project, or this, you know, this part of the project, I looked at the original scene in the show, and it actually is Ride of the Valkyries from Wagner's Ring Cycle opera. Now for me, how I'm handling the scene, I decided to keep it simple, you know, have just like a super, you know, action-filled, you know, modern film score sound, and try not to distract those who are watching it. So let's take a look at what I did.
We're approaching now. Stand by.
Got it.
Mm-hmm.
Disable semi-automatic control. Disable safety features. Maximum speed. Go.
Genres.
We need distance. Head south. In, intersect, maximum speed. Arm charges now. Accelerate.
90%.
More.
94%.
More.
98%.
Stop.
Why the f*** are we stopping?
Get down.
These next two pieces are very different in their styles, but they are both linked for one reason. They are both based off of stories that already exist. So it's kind of like refilm scoring, but instead of scoring a scene, you're actually just, you know, writing music to portray the entirety of the story. So, you know, and I understand for each story, there might not be people who know them well. So to explain each of them, I'm just going to give you like a little montage slash trailer, whatever you want to call it, just to give you the idea of what the story is without spoiling anything. Don't worry, I'm not going to spoil anything in this presentation. With each trailer, I'm going to also include the music that's involved in that story. The first one being a TV show that's based off of a graphic novel series by Robert Kirkman called The Walking Dead, which airs on AMC. So without further ado, let's see what The Walking Dead is about.
What's the difference between men and women?
I mean, every woman I ever let have a key, I swear to God. It's like, come home, house all lit up.
Go, go, go! Put it down!
The bitch shot me. You believe that?
Shane, you do not tell Lori that happened. Ever. You understand?
No, no, no. Leon! You get that ambulance down here, you tell him there's an officer down, you do it now!
Shh, that's it. You hear me? Shh, 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 okay. I'm right here with you, stay with me. You hear me?
Shh, hey, bud.
We're still here.
What was the wound?
Gunshot.
What else? Anything?
Gunshot ain't enough.
Look, I ask and you answer.
Did you get bit?
Bit?
I woke up today in the hospital. Came home, that's all I know.
But you know about the dead people, right?
Yeah, I saw a lot of that. Out on the loading dock, piling trucks.
No, not the ones they put down. The ones they didn't. The walkers. One thing I do know, don't you get bit. Bites kill you. The fever burns you out. But then after a while, you come back.
It could be microbial, viral, parasitic, fungal.
Or the wrath of God.
There's that.
Little girl, I'm a policeman.
The people that we were, the world that we knew is dead. And this new world is harsh. It's a survival of the fittest.
This is what takes us down. This is our extinction event.
All I am anymore is a man looking for his wife and son. Anybody gets in the way of that's gonna lose.
Lori! Carl!
You are not safe. No matter what anyone says, no matter what you think, it only takes 1 second and it's over.
You don't know what it's like. You don't know what it's like out there.
These people are my family.
I'm grateful.
The day will come when you won't be.
This isn't a democracy anymore.
People out there are always looking for an angle. Looking to play on your weakness.
Because if you got something good, that just means that there's someone who wants to take it.
You will be torn apart by teeth or bullets.
Are you okay?
It's tired of losing people.
You step outside, you risk your life. You take a drink of water, you risk your life. And nowadays you breathe, and you risk your life. Every moment now, you don't have a choice. The only thing you can choose is what you're risking it for.
Don't you want one more day with a chance? Instead of just being out here. Instead of just making it. Because right now, this is what making it looks like.
You find out who did this, you bring them to me.
Anger makes you stupid. Stupid gets you killed.
We don't stop
We don't go back. We're at war, and retreat means we lose. Every direction is a question.
You earn what you take.
We're the ones who live.
That is not how we do it.
Because you've never had to do it any other way. You haven't been through it. Not really. Michelle? Not like Rick. If you don't learn, you will die. We will.
I've been doing runs from the start, okay? I know what
it's
like.
Have you ever had to kill people because they'd already killed your friends and were coming for you next? Have you ever done things that made you feel afraid of yourself afterward? Have you ever been covered in so much blood that you didn't know if it was yours, or Walker's, or your friends? Then you don't know.
We're the ones who get things done. You said that. We're the ones who live.
We do what we need to do, and then we get to live. Because this is how we survive. We tell ourselves that we are the walking dead.
One afternoon, I was in my room, and I had remembered that a few friends had told me about a TV show that they're watching called The Walking Dead, and you know how amazing it was. And you know, I wasn't a big Netflix binging guy at the time. But I wanted to see what my friends were obsessing over, and that's when I started watching it. And soon, I was also obsessing over it too. The Walking Dead is a story that's so rich in its in-depth understanding, and it really has a profound way of being emotionally gripping, and that's when you realize it's not really just a story about a zombie apocalypse. It's a story about moral consciousness, and it displays, you know, human behavior in this fictional setting.
She's about to close the door, and she's like, I just gotta tell you one thing. She was like, it's not about the zombies.
See?
It's about the people.
That's right.
She shut the door.
That's right.
She's totally right.
I like to think of it as a zombie apocalypse story through a psychological magnifying glass. And that's when you find yourself sort of identifying with some of these people. And I have to say, the day I started watching it, you know, I really just expected a show about the zombie apocalypse, nothing too far off of that. And I didn't expect this, you know, this intense human-driven arc that it has, which is really what makes the show so great. And this show, to me, is really just about questions. You know, I mean, so many questions that, you know, they even have a talk show where it plays after every new episode where they talk about the event. It's called Talking Dead. They talk about the events of each episode. But the thing about questions and stories is you need to leave room for questions in a story.
He kept saying it, is that the question is more interesting than the answer. And the whole movie just asks questions. We never answer anything. You know, it's like, it's sort of a bit, it's a bit boring. You know, usually the answer is a bit mundane. So to maintain the tension, see if you can just raise the stake in the questions.
I like to say that you never know a story just by watching it the first time or hearing it the first time. You know, it's never all going to be there right away. You know, the next two stories, the Walking Dead and the next one are definitely stories that I've really gotten to know from really going super in depth with them and getting a better understanding of them. Switching gears to the scoring aspect of the show, it's scored by Bear McCreary. And if you watch the show, you definitely know the opening theme very well. Once he created the theme for the series, he used that same instrumentation of the theme as a recurring model for the rest of scoring throughout the series.
My name is Bear McCreary. I'm the composer for The Walking Dead. So the first thing you are going to hear in the main title is this tremolo string line. It's a tremolo repetitive figure in the string orchestra that's very agitated and very aggressive and energetic. And it starts off soft and gets louder and louder. And it's this simple figure that is basically the theme of The Walking Dead. The Walking Dead doesn't have a big, catchy, melodic theme. It just has this little burrowing earworm that I wanted to get stuck in the back of your minds because you hear it over and over and over again during the main title. The instrumentation of The Walking Dead main title is very representative of what the instrumentation for the whole score would later become. It has a very small, intimate chamber orchestra of only strings this was kind of harkening back to the classic early days of the genre with composers like Bernard Herrmann doing Psycho, and guys like Ennio Morricone and Elmer Bernstein, and a lot of the classic early films had very small ensembles, and it was a really intimate and interesting sound that I wanted to reference with The Walking Dead. One of the things that I discovered after I had written the main title and we went to the scoring session to record it, this is a really difficult thing for string players to play. In fact, the string players were joking that it was really like an aerobic workout to be able to play this really aggressive tremolo figure over and over and over again. I didn't realize that when I wrote it, but they really stepped up to the plate and played the hell out of it.
Using that chamber orchestra sound of strings, I also wanted to keep the synth identification and work in a DAW, which stands for Digital Audio Workstation. And the software that I work in is called Logic. It's a DAW that's acquired by Apple as an advanced version of GarageBand. I think one of the challenges writing this piece is that the show itself isn't finished. The comic book is finished, but the story's still going. It's what, on its 10th season now? So, you know, because of that, I think it made it more difficult, but a little more interesting to attempt, because questions.
This story typically displays three types of scenes in so many different ways. So it's either an action scene, an emotional scene, or some kind of character dissension. You know, I think you'll hear a little bit of each of those in this next piece.
I thought you'd take responsibility. I thought you were a cop, not a lawyer. Either way, I don't pretend to be a governor.
So because of all of that, I knew while writing this next piece that I needed to sound tragic, but I had this little pinch of hope, because without hope, you don't have that story. And that, you know, they have to find a reason to stay alive. The part of the show is not just surviving, but it's also rebuilding the world. This piece is kind of meant to represent all of that. And it's based off of a quote that you heard in that montage earlier. There's a scene where Rick said, "We're the ones who live." Later on, Michonne reminds him of the quote's significance. So I call this piece The Ones Who Live. I think that title appropriately portrays the horrors and also the bittersweet ambition to survive on this apocalypse and rebuild this broken world.
Thank you.
Most artists have that one piece that really sparked their passions and inspired them to become artists in the first place. To me, that piece of work has always been the Harry Potter films and story, you know, based off of the books by J.K. Rowling. So to explain the story of The Boy Who Lived to those select few who don't know it, I will give you another trailer, so I hope you enjoy.
You're a wizard, Harry.
I'm a what?
A wizard. And a thumping good one, I'd wager, once you trade up a little.
No, you've made a mistake. I mean, I can't be a wizard. I mean, I'm just Harry. Just Harry.
Well, just Harry. Did you ever make anything happen? Anything you couldn't explain when you were angry or scared?
Dear Mr. Potter, we are pleased to inform you that you have been accepted at Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry.
Welcome to Hogwarts.
Let the feast begin.
Mr. Potter, our new celebrity.
I'm Hermione Granger.
Ron Weasley.
Quidditch is easy enough to understand.
Rough game, Quidditch. Brutal.
Is that a dragon?
It is not our abilities that show what we truly are. It is our choices.
Curious. Very curious.
Sorry, but what's curious?
It is curious that you should be destined for this wand when its brother gave you that scar.
He killed my parents, didn't he? The one who gave me this.
A few years ago, there was one wizard that went as bad as you can go, and his name, Voldemort.
Voldemort?
It was dark times, Harry, dark times. Voldemort started to gather some followers, brought them over to the dark side. Anyone that stood up to him ended up dead. Your parents fought against him. Nobody lived once he decided to kill him. Nobody. Not one. Except you.
Me? Voldemort tried to kill me?
Yes. That ain't no ordinary cut on your forehead, Harry. That's why you're famous. That's why everybody knows your name. You're the boy who lived.
Today, we acknowledge a really terrible loss. We all feel but this dreadful loss reminds me and reminds us that while we may come from different places and speak in different tongues, our hearts beat as one.
Dark and difficult times lie ahead. Soon we must all face the choice between what is right and what is easy.
In school, if you make a mistake, you can just try again tomorrow. But out there, when you're a second away from being murdered, or watching a friend die right before your eyes, you don't know what that's like.
It does not do to dwell on dreams and forget to live.
So what you just watched was a glimpse of my favorite story of all time, the story that made me fall in love with the idea of film scoring. The way the story is so beautifully crafted, I think is what gives you this illusion of feeling like you're part of the story yourself. at Universal Studios, you can experience this Wizarding World firsthand, which is one of the most amazing series of attractions I've seen at any theme park. This really is a story that becomes a transformation from a lighthearted fantasy to this calamitous development, which you kind of see evolve through the course of its musical evolution. Before I continue, I just want to explain the musical elements of the story a little bit first. The composition process, for me, was very painful. Took a lot out of me, using almost 40 instruments. You know, just because of how complex the musical style is as well, not just the instrumentation, but I think just everything about it is just, oh my god, it's insane. If I handed it to live musicians, they wouldn't definitely need time to look over it. And that's kind of what John Williams did for the first movie. You know, for the celeste player and for the string players. Just like the title of The Walking Dead, the theme song to Harry Potter, titled Hedwig's Theme, is very complex. But before it gets so complex, it sounds a little something like this.
Composer will see the film first and then take measurements from the film and decide where the music will go and where it won't go. And that's the normal process. That was the case of Harry Potter, except for one significant deviation. Before I had seen a frame of film, I got a call from Warner Brothers saying that they were going to do a promotional reel of Harry Potter for which they had no music. And would I create some theme? Some music that might be used. So what I wrote was what became Hedwig's theme, which I wrote sight unseen, and when people at Warner's and others heard the music, they felt that it was perfectly appropriate for the film, I was happy to say.
I remember first hearing Hedwig's theme. It was so clear that this was it, and it felt so appropriate. It was sufficiently majestic and magical.
His agents told me that John wanted me to get a copy of the music ahead of time. And that's kind of a little flag that goes up, you know, that says, it's going to be something I need to look at. If he says, I think you should take a look at the music, you better look at the music ahead of time.
Because nobody in the orchestra has sent the music in advance, normally for film sessions. And when the violins first turned up to the recording session, and then they saw the Hedwig's theme, oh no, it's black, you know, lots and lots of notes. And suddenly there was a flurry of everybody sort of practicing very hard.
Well, the opening has this gossamer celeste, and the celeste was a little keyboard instrument that makes pearly sounds. It's like a piano, but it's even more magical than that, somewhere between a piano and a glockenspiel. It's able to play very quick notes also all across the keyboard very quickly, as a pianist would do, or a violinist. It seemed to me a good tool to create this ambiance of the preparation of flight, or the magical ability to escape gravity into flight velocity, as a bird would do.
John, he didn't talk about it a lot ahead of time. Usually on the recording date, he'll say, well, here's what I was thinking.
Randy, you know at the end where you have the tune along
yeah.
with the celeste 127?
Right.
Slow it with me.
Okay.
As though all of that drama hadn't happened.
But pretty much the music is self-explanatory, you know? So it says synth celeste, and it says solo, and it says misterioso. So he doesn't want it on the real celeste, and there are real celestes around, and they're wonderful instruments, but he wanted something a little different, reminiscent of a celeste, but on a synthesizer. Here's just a celeste sample. I wanted something to add to this celeste sample that would be a little more, it would make it a little more ringy and mysterious, and But still keeping kind of the purity of a Celeste sound. The instrument I was using was a DX7, which was an early FM synthesizer. The basic place it starts is it gives you a sine wave, because a sine wave is a very warm sound, doesn't have any overtones on it. Now that doesn't sound very good for... Might sound like early video game or something. So I blend this with the original Celeste sound. So I hear a little bit of that original bell sound, the steel bar sound of the Celeste, but with this sine wave. And that's basically the Harry Potter Hedwig's theme sound.
The main series went through four different composers, starting with John Williams for the first three films, then Patrick Doyle for The Goblet of Fire, Nicholas Hooper for 5 and 6, and then the last two parts of The Deathly Hallows are Alexander Desplat.
The John Williams score that started it all left me with my all-time favorite music scene of any film. I picked these two stories, The Walking Dead and Harry Potter, you know, not only because, you know, they're my personal favorites, they really are both emotionally compelling. This next piece, besides the symphony, is, like I said, is a very difficult piece. And it was actually inspired, the structure, based off of a piece, which is my all-time favorite piece. It's called The Incredible Flutist. And it's by Walter Piston. And it's actually from a ballet, but it's an orchestral suite arranged from a ballet. In The Incredible Flutist, the entire work is split up into continuous short movements, since it's technically a suite from a larger work. In the next Harry Potter piece, you'll hear 9 parts, and you'll see multiple images to represent each section. It's the longest piece before the symphony, so get comfy and enjoy.
Thank you.
I think there's a lot of things that sparked my musical passions, you know, from a lot of great different, you know, movies, composers, you know, whatever. But I think there's one thing that I acknowledge very dearly, and that was the Ridgewood High School band program. I spent all 4 years in high school playing in the marching band, jazz band, the brass ensemble, and curricular band programs, all as a trombone player. I did, you know, I also did pit orchestra for some theater shows. Sometimes I was on stage for theater. I did some theater too, as well as choir. So, and you know, high school for me was just kind of balancing out a lot, you know, between band, choir, theater. There's all these different things. But I think one thing that band offered professionally for me, a lot of the repertoire we did was, you know, Shostakovich and Copland and Gershwin and people that I love listening to. But to show you what that journey was like, here's a montage of that experience.
Thank you. and our trombone section actually wrote this next piece, so I actually asked him to say a couple words about the next piece as he composed it. So here's Nick Gambardello.
So I'm Nick Gambardello, a junior here at RHS, and I'm planning on writing for visual media specifically. That's something that I've been like really interested in. So this is the beginning of my journey. So far it's successful and it's going underway. So I hope you enjoy my piece Underway. And it's kind of about the things that are coming my way. So, thank you. I hope you enjoy it. I got to play some of the most amazing pieces, and I wrote four pieces as well and arranged a few during my time there, but if there's one major takeaway that I've learned, it's associated with the marching band. We had a lot of different traditions. One of them is has to do with our band logo. If you see five stars surrounding it, and each of those five stars are what makes us special, they represent respect, trust, leadership, unity, and pride. And I've learned those five things best from this group, exercising those characteristics, through many things that I've done. It's definitely something that I'm going to remember for a lifetime. But this next piece, it's not written for marching band, but it is a march. It's written for concert band, and it's titled The Five Stars, and it represents the wonderful years that I've spent there. So I hope you enjoy The Five Stars. Thank you.
Music is like architecture, sculpture, and so on, thousands of years old. And film is the new kid on the block, 100 years barely. And though we will watch its evolution carefully, side by side with the art of music, I am enormously grateful, as all composers are, to film for giving us the broadest possible audience worldwide that any composer has ever enjoyed. I'm certain that Beethoven would have shunned it, but Wagner would have had his own studio out there in Burbank.
To those of you who know where my musical passions lie, you are well aware that I've grown to heavily admire the music of composer John Williams. Who I've mentioned multiple times throughout this video, I feel like, but he did the music for the first three Harry Potter films. And in his career so far, he has composed the music for some of the greatest movies, shows, and concerts. And I mean, he's done it all, you know, you name it, you know, with John Williams, you know, you hear that high C on a B-flat trumpet, you know, played by Maurice Murphy, and you know instantaneously what it is. Having written the music for Star Wars, among many other amazing things, I would say him and his music are heavily responsible for allowing me to fall in love with the orchestra and film music. So let's take a look at some of the other things he's done.
Jurassic Park.
They're moving in herds.
Translation airlock on their audio signal. We're taking over this conversation now. We'll be right back.
so funny because there's always another piece that I hear and I find out, oh, he did that too? You know, I mean, he's been everywhere. And you know, I guarantee you've heard so much of John's music and don't even know it's him. I share a birthday, like I said, with my biggest fan and also my biggest idol, February 8th, except for John Williams, it's almost 70 years apart. I remember very specifically one time I was in the car on the way to school in sixth grade and I said to my mom, you know the guy who wrote the music for Harry Potter? He has the same birthday as me. And she said, oh, maybe that's a sign. Maybe you'll be a composer. And I was like, yeah, whatever. When people think of film music, they look up to John Williams. And, you know, that's kind of why he was the maestro that spoke to me. And I think one of my other favorite things about John is the amazing things that people say about him. Everyone says he's just this kind, genuine guy. And, you know, one of the people that who I've heard say that is actually my trombone teacher at Berkeley, who's played in the Pops with him. And he says, everybody in that orchestra, you know, he has everybody's respect there. And I think that's an important detail in this field because, you know, you need the right attitude to have this, you know, substantial amount of respect and recognition. And since film scoring requires working with a lot of people, you know, you're supposed to be a nice guy. I think one thing that separates John's music from other film composers is that he writes them very old school, you know, with a piano, pencil, paper, a calculator to figure out the timing of the scene. A lot of film composers nowadays are left with, you know, synths, and one of the most recognizable composers like that is Hans Zimmer.
She's got no heat shield.
And then there's me, the new kid on the block. So what do I do? You know, I find nowadays it's a lot easier to access information on film scoring. You know, at the end of the day, you want to be a film composer. And the best advice I have is to start old school. You know, with someone like John Williams, you have things like these. This right here. This is the entire score to it's a Star Wars suite. So if you see right here, it has those five tracks. So it's the entire score, and this is kind of where I start, you know, my studying is by looking at these things and really just you know, not just looking at them, but really getting to know them and marking them up and just even though this guy's a traditional you know, uses a traditional approach, I am doing the, you know, the technology side of it. There's you know, scoring technology as a class at Berkeley that I have to take soon. And, you know, working in different softwares like, you know, there's Logic, Cubase, Pro Tools. I personally notate in Sibelius Ultimate. And I, when I'm doing, you know, more mock-up mixing stuff, I use Logic Pro. I once heard Hans Zimmer say, use what works best for you. And lately I've been trying to figure that out. If I'm ever tired or unmotivated, I always watch this scene from E.T., and it always drives me into tears every single time.
Don't crash, please.
The piece you're about to hear is not the first thing you would expect when you hear a John Williams style. You know, it's not the brassy Star Wars Imperial March kind of a piece. Because, you know, John Williams has written so many things in so many styles, I had to ask myself, you know, what do I consider John's sound? And, you know, at first I thought of the styles of, you know, E.T. and Jurassic Park, you know, because that's his signature sound, that's what he's known for. And I also thought, you know, I should start with a fanfare, because he can write the most amazing fanfare whenever he wants. But aside from loving his fanfares and his film music, I do love his marches. You know, Raiders March, Midway, Pops on the March, I think the most are recognizable. Maybe this one. Imperial March. Everybody knows it. Not everybody knows what it's from, but everybody has heard it. It's just one of those things that, like I said, he's just everywhere. He really is.
And it's a good thing. You know, it's when you're able to take the music outside of the story and really just recognize it for what it is, I think it become a really beautiful thing. And you know, with a march too. I think he's really good at marches. And that's not particularly what he's known for, but he's known for being good at marches. At writing, he doesn't just write marches. You know, take like John Philip Sousa, that's the March King. So because of that, I included the March section, which is, I would say, the bulk of the piece. And just in general, I mean, you know, honoring his methods and, you know, choosing John Williams to base a piece off of is, I would say, is a very daring job, because I once heard Nicholas Hooper say, rewriting John Williams is a very dangerous thing to do because he does it best, you know? It's absolutely true. And I think everybody in the film industry and in the music industry would definitely recognize that. But, you know, for me, I need to I really need to move forward. I really need to figure out what it is I'm doing here. I mean, this is my career. So if I'm studying this guy and I'm trying to, you know, if I'm trying to copy his, or not copy his style, but trying to honor his style, you know, it's the one way that I can move forward and learn from all these things. So that's what I did.
Lights came up and the film was over and it was time for Stephen and me to begin to talk about the role of the music. And I was so overwhelmed by the film, I really could not speak. And I went out and walked around the building for a few minutes to gather myself and came back in to start the meeting with Stephen. And I said, Stephen, this is truly a great film. And you need a better composer than I am for this film. And he said very sweetly, I know, but they're all dead.
You might see something in your head and then hear that image come to life, which is film scoring. And you might hear something and then create some kind of visual perspective of it. So that's the reverse. Disney's film Fantasia is a movie that I'm surprised I haven't seen until just recently. As someone who loves classical music and loves Disney, I'm surprised I haven't put the two together yet and watched that movie until recently. But it's a great movie, and basically what it is it takes a bunch of famous classical pieces and puts a visual story to it. So let's take a look at what that might be. Thank you.
All this music has something in common, and that's that they're all complementary to the art of animation. So for this next piece, I wanted to write something that could also be like that. But you know, I don't know a big animator right now. So you know, but if you do, hit me up. Or if you are one especially, let me know. So I titled this piece Painting a Canvas, and I'm going to leave my work to you. You know, I'm just going to, whatever you want to think about it, whatever you want to, however you interpret it is correct. There is no, it's not even correct. There is no correct or incorrect. It's just an idea. You know, I had my own story when writing it. And, you know, I'm not going to tell you what that is, but I'm going to leave it to you. In filmmaking, there's this thing called temp music, which is basically when a director puts temporary music to get a feel of what he wants for the scene. Sometimes he brings it to the film composer and says, I want you to sound like this recording or this piece. And that's a film composer's biggest nightmare, because you don't want any idea, because it's not creative at all, and it almost reaches the brink of plagiarism. So, you know, in order to tell this story without telling the story, I don't want to give you a temp track. You know, I don't want to give you any ideas. I want you to just listen and you know, feel the story, whatever you want it to be. You know, do whatever you want with it. Get creative. And this is time for non-musicians to get creative too. Just in your head, whatever you see. And certainly let me know what you see, because I'm definitely interested in hearing so.
Thank you.
Walt Disney once said, "I hope we never lose sight of one thing, that it was all started by mouse." Because, you know, I mean, it's the butterfly effect. And, you know, for me, you know, like I said, I've been going to Disney for years. And, you know, for me, I would say it's definitely professionally impactful. And just to sidetrack for a second, so is Universal Studios, too. One time I was in Universal, I was about to walk in with, I was with my dad, and we were sitting eating cinnamon buns when we were waiting for the park to open, and I had a cappuccino as well. And I was sitting there, you know, having my breakfast, and while we were waiting there for the park to open, we were still in the park, just waiting for the rest of the park and the rides and everything to open. And I heard a bunch of music playing in the background, because they have, you know, this series of, when you're walking through, they have this montage of different music from different movies, for Universal. So, you know, between Harry Potter and, you know, Jaws, Back to the Future, they play a bunch of different music. And one of the things that they play is, Jurassic Park. So I heard the theme to Jurassic Park, and I didn't know it that well. I hadn't seen the movie at that point. But I was listening to it while I was eating, and I said to my dad, "Hear that? That's the music that I want to write. Like, that's the, you know, that's what I love right there." And I don't have a video of it or anything, but it kind of went a little something like this.
Whoa, that's so cool!
Back to the Disney talk. There's a whole purpose of Disney, which I'm sure Walt Disney either created or commended. You know, the whole reason to keep Disney World functioning 24/7 is, you know, besides the pandemic, is just to take you away from reality and just, you know, feel safe, feel joyful, and just, you know, get away from all the bad news, you know, just experience this ultimate joy. And, you know, one of the best things about Disney is when you walk into the hotel, they say, "Welcome home," which I think is one of the greatest things that they do there. There's this one story that I've probably told 1,000 times by now. One time when I was in Disney, it was New Year's Day, at midnight, in Disney. You know, we had the whole New Year celebration and everything, you know, fireworks and the countdown, and it was awesome. For the next 2 hours after, the countdown, we were just on rides and stuff, just having a good time, you know, as you would in Disney. As we were leaving the park, we had to leave the bus stop for our bus to come. And as we were in the middle of waiting there talking, I think I was talking to my sister, and then I stopped right there, and I was like, "Wait, wait, wait, wait. Do you hear what's playing right now? This is what I heard." And in that moment, I just said, I it finally came to me. I knew I wanted to do something with music, but I didn't know what it was, you know, because I was like, being a performer is, I don't think I want to do that all the time. You know, I love performing, but I don't think that's, you know, for me. And it finally hit me in that moment that I want to be writing. You know, I want to be I want to be the one that's initiating this kid's reaction, you know? My own reaction. I want someone else to have that. So that moment right there was telling me, you're gonna write. That's what you want to do. That's what you're going to do. And my sister reminded me that you can get a degree in music composition. When You Wish Upon a Star, I think, was the perfect piece of music to be playing, because, you know, I mean, it's the anthem of Disney, but it also, I think, just perfectly captures how I felt that night. You know, and if Pinocchio didn't exist, didn't initiate the idea, you know, I wouldn't be saying, "Eureka, I want to be a composer." But fortunately, I had that moment that not everyone gets. And you know, I would say theme park music in particular is something that I very much come to love. And I think that would be a big goal for me. It is a big goal for me. You know, so evidently, this next piece is about that moment. It's about where I had my discovery. And it brings me back to the moment at that Disney transit stop where I had the epiphany to remind myself that a star was wished upon that night when I wasn't asking for one. So, you know, when you listen to it, keep it in mind, the way it's structured, it's like a happy teenager on a roller coaster developing into, you know, this passionate musician loving his art in this symphonic style. Without this piece, you wouldn't have this album. And that is why we will never lose sight of one thing, that it was all started by a mouse. After I realized I wanted to be a composer, I also, you know, had to realize that film scoring was, you know, really the thing. And I thought about, you know, Disney music, because I was like, oh, I love the music of Disney. But, you know, where does that trace back to? And I think most of them obviously trace back to film music. Film music traces to classical music, and, you know, so on and so forth. So, you know, I didn't really think about it like that. Until one time I watched a video called How Pixar Uses Music to Make You Cry, which I'll leave a link in the description of this video. And it really is just 10 minutes of watching that video, and I was instantly just so excited about becoming a composer and getting to do things like this. And then I realized that there are people who are just film composers. Like, that's just what they do. So I was touring colleges, and, you know, one of the schools that I visited was Michigan State. My marching band director went there from high school. When I was at Michigan State, in the administration office, they, you know, we had a little meeting just to hear about, you know, the music department of the school. And one of the things that they said, because I was originally going to do a double major with music education, he said, you know, if you're a music ed, you're probably going to get out, probably doing some sort of a sixth grade band teaching thing right when you get out. And I was like, in my head, I was like, I don't know. Like, look, I think I'll be good at it, and I think I'll enjoy it, but I want to write. And that was the moment that I was like, you know what? I just want to write, because I'm so excited about this composition thing. But as much as I would, you know, enjoy teaching, I'm not as excited about that. And that was the moment that I looked back on that video. I was thinking about that video that I watched during that meeting. I kind of got a little distracted. I forgot what some of the things he was saying, but all I could think of was just that I loved that video and I loved hearing about film scoring, and that's all I wanted to do. And so on the car ride back home, I had my computer out and I was just, you know, with my phone hotspot, I was just, you know, searching all these film composers and just listening to a bunch of film music the whole ride down. And that's when I realized that film music is something that I just want to do all the time. Before I talk about the symphony, let me show you a quick clip of the Boston Philharmonic conductor, Benjamin Zander.
I thought we should do an experiment tonight. An experiment. Actually, it's not really an experiment because I know the outcome. But it's like an experiment. Now, before we... Now, the other thing I wanted to do is to tell you about you. There are 1,600 people, I believe. My estimation is that probably 45 of you are absolutely passionate about classical music. You adore classical music. Your FM is always on that classical dial, and you have CDs in your car, and you go to the symphony, and your children are playing instruments. You can't imagine your life without classical music. That's the first group. It's quite a small group. Then there's another group, bigger group. These are the people who don't mind classical music. You know, you come home from a long day and you take a glass of wine and you put your feet up, a little Vivaldi in the background doesn't do any harm, right? That's the second group. Now comes the third group. These are the people who never listen to classical music. It's just simply not part of your life. You might hear it like secondhand smoke at the airport, but and maybe a little bit of a march from Aida when you come into the hall, but otherwise you never hear it. That's probably the largest group of all. And then there's a very small group. These are the people who think they're tone deaf. Amazing number of people think they're tone deaf. Actually, I hear a lot, my husband is tone deaf. Actually, you cannot be tone deaf. Nobody is tone deaf. If you were tone deaf, you couldn't change the gears on your car in a stick shift car. You couldn't tell the difference between somebody from Texas and somebody from Rome. And the telephone. If your mother calls on their miserable telephone, she calls and says hello. You not only know who it is, you know what mood she's in. You have a fantastic ear. Everybody has a fantastic ear. So nobody is tone deaf. But I tell you what, it doesn't work for me to go on with this thing with such a wide gulf between those who understand, love, and passionate about classical music and those who have no relationship to it at all. The tone deaf people, they're no longer here. But even between those three categories, it's too wide a gulf. So I'm not going to go on until every single person in this room, downstairs and in Aspen, and everybody else looking, will come to love and understand classical music. So that's what we're going to do. Now, you notice that there is not the slightest doubt in my mind that this is going to work, if you look at my face, right? It's one of the characteristics of a leader that he not doubt for one moment the capacity of the people he's leading to realize whatever he's dreaming. Imagine if Martin Luther King had said, I have a dream! Of course, I'm not sure they'll be up to it.
It's one of the characteristics of a leader that he not doubt for one moment the capacity of the people that he's leading to realize whatever he's dreaming. I have never found a quote in that amount of richness, preparedness, and accuracy. So, you know, because of that, I want to honor Zander for, you know, for what he said. And, you know, I sometimes look at the world with full knowledge that there's always something grander in size and in importance, you know, as something that we don't get to see. And, you know, music, I think, is certainly something that reveals that, you know, because music leaves us with thoughts and dreams and wonders of, you know, why we feel a certain way. And I think music is capable of achieving something that couldn't be created by man, only enhanced by man. You know, we couldn't have created music, but we took advantage of it and we let it be great. We let the possibilities be endless. So today I'm going to show you something that I hope you will find empowering. The symphony is a big step in my whole compositional career, my whole musical career. Just writing my first symphony is a big moment. And I did it a little bit early, I'll admit. I wanted to get my hands dirty. You know, and that was all the music that you just heard. I had all the time to do it. So I just wrote a bunch of music before I wrote the symphony. And, you know, because I felt so responsible, like suddenly I had this weight on my shoulders. There's this composer who did Captain Marvel, Fortnite, a whole bunch of things. I actually met her at Berkeley. She once said, and I think she says this in a lot of interviews, I would rather fail doing something that I loved than succeed doing something that I don't want to do. And, you know, to me, I loved the idea of writing the symphony. I loved that, you know, I was inspired to do it myself. After all these different, you know, composers that I've listened to, I was like, it's time for me to do this big project myself. You know, and I had to remind myself what Mozart did at 8 years old. You know, I was 5 when I had my first piano lesson. And, you know, thanks to my grandmother's suggestions, like I said, you know, and I started taking piano lessons from that point at a local conservatory for mostly younger children. That was there for about 10 years. And then 5 years in that time, I learned trombone, joined the marching band in high school, and soon after that realized that I want to be a composer. This symphony number 1 is titled All I've Known. And it's about that experience and my growth into this incredible journey and lifestyle and my moment in this path. This first movement, as the beginning, certainly the most frightening to write. And that's what the exposition is about. The exposition, for those of you who don't know, it's written in a form that's called sonata form. If you aren't a musician, let me explain what that means. It's like a 3-part ABA setup. So to explain the form of the first movement, very briefly, imagine that you have person A and person B. And person A has an opinion and person B has another opinion. That's the exposition. Then comes the development, where they recklessly sort out their perspectives until the recapitulation, where they both mutually settle on some sort of a conclusion. And that's what this movement feels like. This movement in my symphony as a personification of a discussion is not an argument. I like to think of it as a discussion between a student and a teacher / mentor. And the student, in the very beginning of the exposition, believes that he isn't ready to take on this upcoming journey and challenge. He isn't ready to be writing a symphony. So, you know, and the mentor or teacher, which is really just a combination of all the people that the student has learned from, tries to reassure him of his abilities in this very calm, well-fleshed-out opinion. And this develops into a bit of a peppy conversation in the development section, where the student and the mentor look back and further discuss what it is they've come to learn up to this point in time. At the recapitulation, there's a final conclusion of the conversation, and there's this sort of realization of, you know, not only what they remembered from the past, but, you know, the brand new things that they've discovered in the process of doing that. And the student becomes more and more passionate about what he's learned, you know, knowing that there's still this fear of doing this so early, but he's come to accept that and he's come to take control of that. And the mentor is really just becoming more passionate about his, you know, in his pride of the student's power and ambition. I think the moral of this movement is that while you may not register this yet, you know, all of us are students and all of us are teachers, because although, you know, we may not be in a classroom 24/7, you know, every single day we're learning new things and we're always sharing that. We're experiencing life in a different light. The second movement is a fun little ditty. It's the shortest movement of the symphony, you know, just under 4 minutes. You know, but it's packed with a lot of stuff, and it's basically about my musical evolution thus far, and my obsession with not only the emotion, but the craft itself. And it's in 4 parts. It's like a theme and variations form, which is a self-explanatory form. It basically takes an original theme and displays multiple variations, all linked to the base ideas of the original theme. And the movement reflects the way I have evolved as a musician, composer, and individual. And it's also good practice, I would say, for, you know, since I'm going into film scoring, it's a great idea to attempt a singular theme in several variations. So I'm going to briefly explain the theme in each variation. The theme is labeled as a little tune, and it's very youthful and coherent, and it gives you what the theme is in the beginning, that you're going to be hearing throughout. And it kind of drifts away from the previous, you know, classical styles and sounds a little bit like a film score. You know, but it basically represents my early interest in the field of music as I started at the age of 5. And it's about the way I started to hear things, you know, before I dug into the complexity of the craft. The first variation is labeled questions and answers, and it brings me closer to the paper. You know, it reminds me that while I enjoy what I'm hearing, I have to be capable of seeing it too. And to be honest, I solely allowed my ear to get me by a little too long. I was using my ear for way too long. It wasn't until, you know, I started playing trombone that I started reading music more. The second variation is labeled patience of the craft, and it's a much softer and slower variation in the movement. And, you know, it's the only variation that isn't at the vivace tempo. It's mostly a very fast tempo. And it shows both maturity in not only learning more about this craft, but learning how to take care of it respectfully. And it's a little eerie if you listen to it. It's an ambient. The third and final variation is called Mastering the Craft. And the first part represents my exuberant yet contained approach at making music. And it reminds you that you can go a little crazy with difficulty, just enough to express a certain idea, but also be generous and proper in the music to future musicians who end up playing it. You know, and the ending section of the variation and piece is a bit more thematic, and it represents the success in the mark of my journey. And together, the entire final variation kind of feels like some sort of an action scene evolved into this heroic result of the main theme, and it represents my optimism in the craft. So this third movement, it's the longest of the symphony, and you see the whole symphony tells the story of how much I've come across up to this point in writing the symphony itself. And one of the questions I've certainly had is, you know, do I love this thing enough to go through with how, you know, the complicated parts of it? You know, it can get really, I mean, I've been pulling my hair out doing this project, you know, like not all of it is enjoyable, but do I love it enough that, you know, that it's really the passion for me that I'm going to turn into a living? And, you know, the answer is yes, it is. And I've realized that several ways, you know, and the movement title, All I Loved, you know, can mean all sorts of things. You can love music, you know, you can love a place, but most importantly, and I think the point of focus of this movement is that you can love people.
Aww.
And, you know, this movement highlights the significance of human relationships and why we share things, you know, why we're a part of each other's lives. The movement actually opens and ends with a chorale. The intro chorale is titled Chorale for a Community, and I'll just in a minute get back to what it represents. The rest of the movement follows the opening chorale in ternary form, which is simply an ABA setup. So the A section is a repetition of all the great things about love. And stylistically, I gave this feeling kind of a cheesy Hollywood love theme, but it brings entirely light and this emotional warmth that certainly touches your heartstrings in a positive way. The B section is a bit more patient, and it brings some of the sadder things that love can bring. Looking back, there's this one time that when I was in high school, we did this thing called the final hour. This was my last time in that building as a student. And we basically what it was with my theater group. We get 1 hour to do whatever we want in the theater. And then right before we left the building, our director sat in a circle and just had a conversation before we left, listened to our senior song one more time. And one of the things that my teacher said that was a quote from that song was, "The price of love is loss." And, you know, the meaning of that is something that, you know, I've definitely gotten to know better since she said that. And it reminds me, there was two other quotes that are similar to that. And I think give the same message. One of them is from Winnie the Pooh, and that's, "Oh, how lucky I am to have something that makes saying goodbye so hard." The second quote is actually a quote from the U.S. sitcom The Office, and here's a clip of that.
"I wish there was a way to know you're in the good old days before you've actually left them. Someone should write a song about that."
I didn't fully realize this until I graduated high school, and then again with the loss of my grandmother. All of that brings us to the recapitulation. So the A section once again, which kind of molds together all the ideas, you know, to you know, value love while learning to cope with the sad parts of it as well. I hate to bring in another point of reference, but this next quote is just simply too powerful to leave out, and it's from Harry Potter.
The ones that love us never really leave us. And you can always find them in here.
Everything that beautiful quote stands for is what the recapitulation reminds us. And it reinforces the idea that while we still have that love, we won't lose anything that we care about. So like I said, there is an intro and a coda, like a chorale for a community is the name of the intro. And then the coda is labeled as a chorale for a family. This coda is almost entirely identical to the intro. The most obvious difference is instead of a wind quintet, you hear it's just the strings playing, which is like what we call the string family. This is also inspired by another quote that was in The Walking Dead.
You said you're a family. That's what you said. Absolutely amazing to me how people with completely different backgrounds and nothing in common can become that.
You see, in the beginning of the movement, you have a community. And as the movement progresses, you know, and you get to develop your understanding of love, this community evolves into a family. The fourth movement comes out of nowhere. Now, the fourth movement of the symphony answers the question of, am I ready? There's this great quote from Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix that answers that question.
Think of it this way. Every great wizard in history has started out as nothing more than what we are now, students. If they can do it, why not us?
Now, while I'm proud of the symphony, despite being someone who's always criticizing his work, I view this as a breakthrough in my my musical path. You know, listening to this movement played back digitally told me that if a robot can play it well, then people can play it better. It's titled All I Can See because it's about the future. You know, the way we phrase it is that we look into the future. You know, that's how we say it. So all I can see is what I see coming my way. And you know, it's all about a choice. You know, I wrote this movement the way I wanted to, because I wanted to choose what my future is. And that's the thing, is we get to choose. And there are things that you don't get to choose, but you know, we need to take advantage of what we are able to. And that's kind of what the fourth movement represents. I mean, I look forward to every project I get to be a part of. You know, I love what I do, you know, and I think it shows me, and that shows me a future that I can't even see yet. Deciding to do this project was a choice. You know, it didn't feel like a choice when I realized it, you know, because I was like, oh, this is when I have to do it. But I didn't have to do it. I did it because I wanted to do it. So, you know, everything that you just heard is everything that I've known and everything that inspires me to make decisions for myself. Because everything, there's this, that Benjamin Zander conductor, he has this philosophy called The Art of Possibility. It's a book. And he's mentioned it in several presentations. But one of his points is that everything is invented. When you think about the things that were not created by nature, everything is invented. You know, from this piano right here to that camera and that camera, just everything that we get to allow to make our lives easier is invented. You think about the things that we choose to do, the things that we choose to be, that's an invention. And, you know, I mean, why would we speak words if the Phoenicians didn't create the alphabet? There's a lot I have to say about this. And, you know, although I'm going to wrap it up right now, the conversation isn't over. I think there's still a lot about this subject that we could talk about, a lot of different subjects, really, just to share with each other and to gain from each other and, you know, just remember that the conversation has only begun, and the title All I've Known will have evolved over time. All that is what I've known from doing the symphony, or you know, and that's what the story, or really I should say the idea, is all about. One more thing: after the premiere, the video will still be up, so you can rewatch this whole thing again, listen back to the different pieces, and as a bonus, tomorrow night there will be three extra pieces that didn't make it into this album that I also wrote during quarantine that I won't share tonight, but I'll share tomorrow with you at 8 p.m. If you want to hear any of my other pieces afterwards, I have two albums, an album and an EP. Walk Before You Run is my first album, and then my EP is titled New Worlds. But anyways, I've said a lot. I've been speaking for hours, and you can tell in my voice that I am exhausted. So I'm just going to leave it right here. Anyways, let's, without further ado, I hope you enjoy Symphony Number 1, All I've Known. Here it is.
Thank you. Thank you.
to my family, my friends, teachers, mentors, inspirations, and just anybody else who has contributed to making this whole thing possible. Thank you. Thank you very much. Just in the audience as well. Anybody out there who's looking at this right now, just thank you for being a part of my journey. And it's been incredible, and I can't wait to see what happens next. This album will be released tomorrow, September 2nd. Also, check out my two other albums, as I said. Lastly, make sure to stick around for an after credits scene. Anyways, I'm exhausted and I need to go into hibernation, so I'm just gonna let this video free. And I hope you enjoyed this whole thing. Take care and keep this conversation going.